Hey everyone, I'm Fiona. I'm with my friend Alex, and we were classmates together in Santa Cruz a few years ago. And Alex is a composer, singer-songwriter, and also works with a lot of microtonal tuning systems, I guess. Can you introduce yourself more?
Hey Fiona, thanks for having me. Well, like you said, composer and singer-songwriter. I also collaborate with a lot of dancers and filmmakers. I do music for film, and I got into the microtonal world when I moved to California to go to CalArts to do a master's. And I took this class about just intonation by this composer, Wolfgang von Schweidnitz.
The guitarist, right?
Well, he's not a guitarist. He's a composer who, I think his primary instrument is piano.
But okay, I'm thinking of a different guy. Maybe he's the heavy metal guy at CalArts.
Oh, that's Ulrich Krieger, who yeah. I also studied with.
Okay, yeah, I met him at CalArts many years ago.
Yeah, he's great. He's also really knowledgeable about different tuning systems, and he does incorporates that in his music as well. And I actually perform with him in the Partch ensemble. I've studied with him, and then we performed together after graduating.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, I just when I moved to California is when I got immersed in that world, because it seems like, well, there's definitely a whole West Coast culture of microtonality in composition. So, yeah.
And I'm just curious, like, what does changing the tuning system do in general to a piece of music? Like, I feel like most people a lot of composers don't really look at the tuning system. So I actually think that you're like in the minority. Most people are kind of okay with the equal temperament. They've kind of just been working with what they've been given, you know? Who kind of really opened you up to that there's more than just equal temperament?
Yeah. Well, definitely Harry Partch, and Lou Harrison was another one. Mm-hmm. Which actually, let me grab my guitar because I want to play something. When I got into microtonality, it was tricky because I was learning about these intervals that were, you know, that were fascinating, you know, that were based on the harmonic series, and that was just so exciting, and it sounded great. But then as a guitarist, how do you begin to even incorporate that in the music? Because we have frets on the guitar that is, you know, kind of the quintessential, you know, it's just as limiting as the piano in a way, because we have these fixed notes that are in equal temperament, that are not based on the harmonic series, but an equal division of intervals, which leads to, you know, notes being not in tune with the harmonic series. Like, as you know, I'm sure the major third is significantly sharper.
Yes, 14 cents on the piano, it's 14 cents sharper.
Yeah, exactly. So there's one thing that got me excited about just intonation was that I'm able to access more in tune versions of notes that I'm familiar with, right? Like the major third. So I'm playing with the slide so I can get just intonation.
That's awesome.
Versus the that's the equal temperament. You know, it's these subtle differences, inflections, that I was excited about. But the other thing that's really exciting about just intonation is that you can get into intervals that are totally outside anything the piano can do in terms of, just completely different intervals. And actually, I have my pick with. Oh, let me get my pick. I'll be right back. This one piece. This is the first. As I was researching, microtonal guitar music, wanting to kind of figure out how to start incorporating this, I came across this piece, which you can't probably read, but it's a piece, Scenes from Nick Chan by Lou Harrison. And it is one of the last pieces he wrote in his life. And he designed a microtonally fretted guitar to go with this piece. It's a National Steel guitar, and it has 12 notes per octave, but they're not equally spaced. And it's this the scale is this really nice combination of notes that are familiar, kind of more in tune versions of notes that are familiar, with these intervals that are really kind of out there. That's one interval. It's right in between a major seventh and a minor seventh. That's one of the, and then here's another one. That is 30 some cents flatter than a minor third. So he's working with these intervals in this piece, and I'll just play the very beginning of it. Let's see if I can remember this. That's the kind of sound world it is. So, there's, right, you hear these intervals that are familiar, yet then there's these that feel like they're kind of stretching your ear in a way.
Yeah, it really reminds me of like a sitar, or like just the flexibility of the pitch. Yeah, and it also could be just, with the slide kind of sound, kind of gives it that characteristic.
Yeah, I think Lou Harrison was definitely influenced by Hindustani music in these guitar pieces. I mean, he even has one piece, one of the movements is called Jala, which is a section in a raga. And he calls for the slide as well in this. He's going for that sound.
Right. And so his guitar, the frets are kind of different. They're placed differently all over, are there no frets on his guitar?
On his guitar, the frets are placed differently. It's on the internet. Let me see if I can find it.
Oh, okay.
So that's what the guitar looks like.
Okay. Yeah, I remember Larry Polanski showing it to his class.
Oh, really?
I think so.
That's cool. Yeah, I believe that. So that guitar, I actually... My first microtonal guitar that I played was the prototype of this guitar.
Oh, wow.
Harrison himself worked with. And I I got it because I looked up this guy. I was living in LA at Cal Arts at the time, and I looked up this guy, John Schneider, who is a LA microtonal guitar player. And I asked him, how can I get into this world? How can I get my hands on a guitar like this? And so he said, well, I actually have this prototype of the Lou Harrison guitar for rent if you want to try it out.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, so I got to, I rented it for 2 years and yeah, really fell in love with it. When I say microtonality, I think is a big umbrella term for a lot of different kinds of tuning systems that, I mean, I think much of the music around the world could be considered microtonal in you know, certain aspects. Just intonation is a kind of branch within microtonality, maybe. It's specific to the harmonic series.
Right.
The harmonic series being, you know, this
infinite, yeah.
This mm-hmm. infinite series of notes that is embedded within each, you know, guitar note or piano note that we hear, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. So this particular tuning is in just intonation. In a kind of just intonation. And so the ratios here all correspond to these pitches, and the ratios have, they indicate a lot of things about each pitch. For example, where the notes are derived from in the harmonic series.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, for example, the 7 to 6, you see the number 7 there, which indicates that it's derived from the 7th partial. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right there. It's derived from that partial.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing for the B, you know, the natural, the pure major third, 5, indicates the 5th partial, which is the major third. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, major third.
The top is vibrating 5 times for how much the 4th partial is vibrating at. Is that how that ratio works?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, if you were to play like an interval of the major third. The lower note would be vibrating 4 times for every 5 times the high note vibrates. So the ratio indicates a sort of relationship between two notes, right? The 1-to-1 being the other note. And so this is, yeah. So the 1-to-1 is kind of like the note where everything emerges out of. Mm-hmm. Derived from. That's what 1-to-1 means in just intonation. Yeah, so this one, the 1-to-1 is G. So that is the sort of root of all these other notes.
Got it. Yeah, like in equal temperament, you're going to see not whole number ratios. You're going to see like decibel numbers because everything's divided by 12.
Exactly.
So it's not going to be nice, you know, whole number ratios.
Right. Right. Yeah. There's going to be some messy, not whole integer numbers.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So So Lou Harrison, I would say, is a big influence with how he works with the guitar and microtonality and just intonation. Harry Partch is also a big influence. He's probably the best known just intonation, West Coast just intonation composer. Just because he had, he's a quirky guy who has kind of an incredible story, and he also invented a whole orchestra of instruments.
Yeah, tell us about that. The instruments that he invented. Yeah, so he actually died in the 70s, I believe.
Yeah.
So he's a pretty recent guy. Did you ever, you probably didn't, you weren't old enough to meet him.
I never met him. I know. I did not exist.
Right. But you're playing in his ensemble. So that's really cool.
Yeah, we play, so Harry Partch, yeah, I guess I'll start with the instruments. I have all the pictures here. These are some of his instruments that he created himself, conceived and created and built. He actually learned to, he studied carpentry and he worked with different luthiers, but he basically made these instruments himself. And a lot of them are percussion instruments. As you can see here, there's different types of marimbas, the diamond marimba, which is really cool because it's very unique because you can get these chords that you can just swipe from left to right and get these chord sweeps that you could never play on an actual marimba.
Oh.
And some of the other instruments that he has worked with is the gourd tree. The gourd tree is 12 gong, or meditation bowls, basically, bells that are affixed to gourds. And we have one of these in the Perch Ensemble, and I wrote a piece that incorporates this as well. So I've worked with this in my music as well.
Wow. So where do these instruments, where are they at?
They're in LA right now. we have a percussion rental place that holds them. And then whenever we rehearse, we put them in the rehearsal space. The ones that we play, the ones pictured here are the original instruments that Perch made. The ones that we play are remakings of the originals that the leader of the Perch Ensemble has created in the past 20 years. He's worked with luthiers to build and rebuild all of these.
Mm-hmm.
And he's, yeah, using all the, because Parch wrote all the specs for the instruments, so they're absolutely, it's possible to be able to recreate these instruments. So there's the instruments we play are in LA. The original ones, I think, are at a university in Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's another set of instruments in Germany. There's another group ensemble that plays, that's like us, called Ensemble Fabrique, I think.
Wow, this is so cool. These are so beautiful. I'm wondering if he knew Daniel Schmidt, who's an instrument builder, composer. He actually taught at Mills College when I was there. And I know he was working with Lou Harrison, probably, I'm thinking.
Yeah, because Parch was involved. He had lectures or did performances at Mills College as well. So, yeah, there tries the connection there. I've never heard of him. I'll have to check them out.
Okay. Yeah, these are really cool. I really want to hear how they sound.
Yeah, I can play a little bit of my piece for the gourd tree.
Okay.
And the other side of his instruments are string instruments. So and these are the ones that I play in the ensemble. So he's done a series of guitars that are what he calls adapted guitars. And their guitar is often played with a slide, like a Pyrex slide that you could see on the upper right. Yeah, there are modifications of acoustic guitars and Hawaiian lap guitars. And then the adapted viola is a cello fingerboard on a viola body
Wow.
with all those dots indicating the microtones of his scale, which I should mention, he's famous for developing a 43 note to the octave scale.
Right.
That's all his music is in this 43 tone
Right.
scale.
So you would have to either use instruments that he created in order to play his music, or use the voice, or anything that's not equal temperament, basically.
Yeah, exactly. He created these instruments because he was unsatisfied with traditional instruments' ability to kind of access these intervals. Although some of them, like the viola, like the string instruments, have the capacity to play that. So it's just a matter of getting the players who can hear those intervals and yeah, the markings on the fingerboard help out too.
Right. I would say, like, being able to hear those micro pitches is very hard if you're not aware of it. 'Cause I remember before I knew about like just intonation, I was like, oh, I thought equal temperament, like that meant like everything was in tune, you know? And I didn't realize until I heard just intonation and mean tone temperament that I was like, oh my gosh, like it kind of was I don't know, it was like my ears were being adjusted. But I think the main thing with equal temperament is that it's not, you don't see it in nature. It's something that's very man-made. And it's also intervals together that if it's an equal temperament, it's like the shape keeps wobbling. It never really kind of settles into its full shape. I don't know if you've seen that video where it compares like the equal temperament with the different with just intonation. Equal temperament, just everything is really still moving. It's almost like it's not really still. So some people will kind of relate that to, oh, well, an equal temperament, the listening to that music makes us feel like we're not really in a place of peace or stillness. It's like we're constantly kind of in this like chaotic vibration. Whereas like when you're in something that's really in tune, it's going to really create that sense of peace and stillness and groundedness. But I just noticed a difference like with North Indian classical music, how it's all about the being in tune. And then, you know, a lot of Western music that's played really fast, if you think about it. And it's like because, you know, like North Indian classical music is very slow. And then a lot of our classical music and Western art music is played very fast. So it's almost like they play it fast so that we don't hear it, how out of tune it is, possibly. I don't know.
I think you're right in a way, especially also the techniques of vibrato, and vibrato is a kind of a way to obscure the note
Right.
pitch tuning of it, right? Because it's wavering in the intonation pitch. So there are, yeah, the techniques in what Western art music are tend to obscure those subtle pitch relationships. And as you say, in North Indian Hindustani music, yeah, it's the way it's set up, it's you get to really appreciate the tuning subtleties. And Hindustani musician approaches microtonality in a very different way than Harry Partch, who's really interested in all the ratios and the mathematical understanding. There, it's more of an intuitive understanding of tuning, but they get to these same intervals that are, the ratio, the different specific ratios, but they get to them just using their ear.
Oh, wow.
Which is really cool. And also you'll hear this in blues music too, slide guitar delta blues players, you know, playing a minor third that's way flatter on piano. And you notice a lot of music around the world approaches microtonality in an intuitive way. I'm really interested in both sides and kind of the math behind it, but then also using one's ear and kind of intuiting the notes as well.
Yeah, I think that like equal temperament is not really natural for us. I think it's like if you go into the wild, like birds and stuff, they're going to be using just intonation when they're singing and stuff. But like, say like a parrot that grew up in a human household, it's probably going to be singing in the equal temperament. But just the fact that we're bombarded by, you know, on the radio, it's like 99% of everything that we're listening to is in equal temperament. That doesn't happen in nature, I feel like. So I feel like we have that innate ability to kind of intuitively know what's in tune, what's out of tune, but we've just been kind of, you know, programmed out of it.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think so. You know, I mean, it's like also just within the context of music, barbershop quartet, they're gonna sing in just intonation naturally.
Yeah. And I don't want to say like equal temperament is bad, because it's like, it's what, you know, Bach was able to modulate from one key to another key and do that, you know, whereas if you were to stay completely in tune, you wouldn't be able to modulate like that if you were in a fixed temperament instrument like the piano or keyboard or fretted guitar. So yeah, that's, I think that when I had that realization, that's when I started to kind of focus more on my voice and do less with piano, just because I was like, oh my gosh, now I could hear how out of tune those thirds are. You know, it was almost just like a crisis. So I was just like, well, at least I have my voice. I could use my voice still.
Yeah. And you've written a lot of string quartet music, right?
Right. And so that can be emancipated out of equal temperament too.
Yeah, that's another thing. You know, string quartet, I think, also has a tendency to play in these using just intervals.
Right.
So that's a really nice thing about string players.
Yeah, Ben Johnston, his string quartets are just amazing.
Oh yeah, they are. They're incredible.
And he does like all the ratios like in the score and stuff like that.
Yeah, those are very hard to play for the string players, because like I said, string players have a natural tendency of just intonation, you know, tuning in just intonation, but for Ben Johnston's music, it's really specific, and it's using intervals that are way higher up in the harmonic series. I think Ben Johnston even goes higher than Harry Partch in terms of the harmonic series. I think he goes all the way up to the 13th partial.
Oh, wow. Okay.
He derives his notes from all the way up to the 13th partial. So it's definitely a challenge. I actually got to see, before he died, he gave a lecture at CalArts, and I got to see him. A quartet performed one of his string quartets, so it was really special, because he was 90 years old, you know.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, he's
yeah, great. Definitely. If you've not, to our audience, if you've not heard of his string quartets, I highly recommend them.
Mm-hmm.
They're some of the most amazing string quartet pieces that are in just intonation, would you say, or is
yeah.
it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Anyway, back to this.
But yeah, it's actually interesting to compare Ben Johnston and Harry Partch, because I think Ben Johnston was friends with Harry Partch, and he studied with Harry Partch, I think, or was his assistant. But he had a different approach. Instead of inventing his own instruments, Ben Johnston got interested in using traditional instruments and how to work within those limitations to get to these just intonation intervals.
Right.
Harry Partch, his music, his 43 tone to the octave scale, is this cool combination of familiar intervals with intervals that are unfamiliar. So he goes up to the 11th partial. Let me get my guitar again. So the 11th partial. So this is the 7th partial. Which is the minor 7th compared to. That's the equal temperament.
Wow.
Different, right? And the 11th partial, so a lot of Harry Partch's notes are derived from this interval. The other big one is this one, which in the context of a full chord, which sounds, I'm fascinated by this chord because it sounds otherworldly, but then at the same time, it sounds right. It sounds like, oh, it makes sense.
Right.
Right. So that's the interest. That's what I love about just intonation. It kind of stretches your ear outside of the equal temperament. But then there's a sort of innate way we listen to music through, which is through the harmonic series, that it feels like foreign and natural at the same time. Anyway, so he uses this interval to derive a lot of his notes in the 43 tone scale as well.
Okay.
Wonder if I have. Oh yeah, this is the wow. Scale. A lot of so when I'm reading the Partch ensemble, this is what I'm reading. I'm reading all these ratios.
Wow.
And I actually have. Do I have
some
stuff for? Oh yeah, here we go. This is one. So for this is a piece called Barstow that we've played in the ensemble, and this is just a glimpse of the score. And I play the SK surrogate kithara.
Oh wow.
Kithara is an ancient Greek instrument that he reworks, and this instrument is eight strings, set of eight strings, and then another set of eight strings above it that you play almost like a lap steel guitar. But the slide is below the strings. So you play it with the slide. And anyway, the ratios here tell me where to put the slide. So, and the note heads are actually not the sounding notes. They're just a sort of tablature that tells me what strings to play. Needless to say, it took me a second to kind of get oriented with this music, because it's not only musical instruments he invented, but he created a whole notation system specific for the instruments.
Yeah, you have to do a lot of math in your head to be able to find these ratios, is it more intuitively that you're like, or is this marked on the neck or of the instrument?
Yeah, it's marked on the instrument.
Okay, that makes it easier.
Yeah, it does. There, but they end up being kind of approximations of where you should put the slide. So, you have to use your ear and just be able to lock into the interval with the other instruments. But you do have the guideposts of the indicators on the instrument. So this is a recording of Barstow.
Number one.
January 26th. I'm Prince Ed Fitzgerald, age 19. 5 feet 10 inches, black hair, brown eyes. Going home to Boston, Massachusetts. It's 4 and I'm hungry and broke. I wish I was dead. But today I am a man.
Oh, that's so cool. Yeah, it sounds, there's an otherworldly feel to it, but like when I'm listening to this, it almost feels like I could keep listening to it more and more. It's like there's just something that's so intriguing about it.
Cool. Yeah, it's amazing music.
Like, it just feels like it's really thought out, and I know it is. It's really thought out. Like, if this was just an equal temperament, it wouldn't have the same effect. This, it just feels like it all kind of hugs itself. It like has a nucleus to it. It like has a strong center. I'm having a hard time explaining, but it just feels like it's really, it's almost like I can kind of see it visually, like everything is working together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it immediately feels like this different sound world that, you know, your ears are. It seems to take a moment to get the ears adjusted to the sound world. But then once you are, you're kind of in it, and you're able to kind of, even someone who, you know, is hearing parts for the first time, I think, it just takes a little bit of time to get one's ear acclimated, and then you can kind of appreciate the sounds.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just, there's just, this really sounds so different from anything else, that it, but it feels like it has a good, I don't know, there's like a good energy to it. I feel like it nourishes my soul in some way. My ears are appreciating it a lot. Like, when I've been listening to a lot of equal tempered music, it just, I don't know. There's almost like an apathy, lethargic feeling I get, which is, I hate to say that, but it's like, since I'm aware of the tuning now, it's like, this is like just a whole different experience.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the things I'm thinking about right now is the voice, as we've talked about with the voice connection. He's very interested in the spoken word. Mm-hmm. The spoken word, when we speak, we're actually doing all these inflections that are complex and not in line with equal temperament. You know, if you were to analyze our speech, we'd be going up and down, and you know, so this fascination with bringing music out of spoken word is in ancient Greek and Chinese music, and Partch was really fascinated with that. And so in this piece, you'll hear there's this narrator that is, but it's inflected, it's intoned speech, right? Hmm. So if you look at the score, it's very specific what the speaker is doing in terms of the notes, the rhythms. So Harry Partch really thought about these shapes of the spoken word and how he could bring that out in the music. And in his scale, he can bring out really specific nuance in the inflections through all these, you know, microtones. Mm-hmm. Closer to those natural inflections of the human voice.
So he tried to mimic how we would naturally say these words.
Yeah. He's talked about his process where he, before even playing an instrument, you work on just speaking words. If he's working with text in a piece, that's the way he often worked. Was he just, it's January 26th, I'm freezing, Ed Fitzgerald, age 19. But he would just recite. So, yeah, for this particular piece, he found a bunch of hitchhiker inscriptions in Barstow, California. And so that's the text of this piece. It's kind of like a found text.
Oh, that's so cool.
Yeah. But that's the other connection with ancient Greece is that a lot of the ancient Greek theorists were very interested in these ratios as well. You know, Pythagoras, Ptolemy, all these ancient Greek music theorists were very influential for Partch, and he writes about that in his book.
Yeah, Genesis of Music.
Yeah, this is his famous book that he wrote, and he writes all about these influences and all about his instruments and everything. And these are some of the albums that my band has done, Partch Ensemble.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, we did. I didn't tell you, but our Korea tour got postponed.
Oh, the recent one?
Yeah, it got postponed.
Oh.
For next year, just because of coronavirus.
Right. Where are you guys going to be touring?
In South Korea, in a particular town called Tongyeon Music Festival. So we're going to play 3 shows at that music festival.
Wow. Are you going to bring the instruments with you guys?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I know. We have, yeah. It's going to be quite a transportation.
Yeah,
we have specialized cases for a lot of the instruments, so they're protected in the cases.
But, okay, good.
But we are playing in at Red Cat, which is a music venue in Los Angeles that we typically do an annual concert at Red Cat. So we're playing that in June, and we're actually playing with the Del Sol String Quartet.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I know you've written for them, right?
Yeah, I did my second string quartet. They're an amazing string quartet.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Really. They did a lot of Ben Johnson stuff as well. But they've covered a lot of music. I really, yeah, they're great, great string quartet to work with.
Amazing. Yeah, some of the ways I've been influenced by this approach to music, Harry Partch's approach to just intonation and spoken word, is in this song cycle I wrote called 81 Dao Songs, and it's a collection of 81 songs, which is this setting of the entire Dao De Jing. The Dao De Jing is an ancient Chinese text by Lao Tzu with 81 verses. Short verses, kind of pieces of wisdom. And over the course of several years, I set all of these verses to music. And in some of the song, the instrumentation is all over the map for the 81 songs. But some of the songs, I use Harry Partch instruments, which lets me also get into the different tuning systems. So this one right here, voice and sound, it's kind of similar to, I'm using the ratios that Partch is using as well. And I'm using one of his adapted guitars, which is the Hawaiian guitar with 6 strings, and they're all tuned in unison to a G.
Oh, wow.
And you use a slide to play it, and the fingerboard is all colorful, all laid out, telling you all the different ratios. You put your slide on there, get that ratio. So this piece right here is the second song, and it features John Schneider, the leader of the Partch Ensemble, performing one of the adapted guitars and speaking in tone speech.
Having and not having, always together. Difficult and easy complement each other. Long and short contrast each other. High and low rest upon each other. Voice and sound harmonize each other. Front and back follow one another. Therefore, the 10,000 things rise and fall without cease, creating yet not possessing. Working yet not taking credit. Work is done, then forget it. Creating yet not possessing. Working yet not taking credit. Work is done, then forget it.
Well, I really like that. The rhythms that you wrote for the words and just this kind of repeating ostinato pattern that happens, that changes, right? And then the space between that, he chooses how long between each phrase.
Exactly.
Yeah, it just felt very, very natural. It didn't even feel like a performance. It just felt very, very improvised, which is really cool. Just like how it's naturally is, how we naturally talk.
Cool. Yeah. I knew John would be good at that because he's a radio host. So he has this way of speaking that just is so natural and musical. So I definitely thought of him for this piece, and he did a great, great work.
Yeah. And the pitches too, just like the rest upon each other, like, you know, kind of going down and forths. And just the timbre of his voice, how it changes as he kind of changes the pitch. His voice is very soothing too. I feel like some people's voices, it's funny, I was talking to my friend about this software that can kind of detect which frequencies your voice is missing. And it feels like his voice kind of fills up the whole sonic spectrum. Like it's a very full voice.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, he also recorded it really beautifully. So, you know, I think the way he recorded it captures the fullness.
Mm-hmm. It has this quality of, is it AMSR, ADSR, where it's like it's a very like ear textural. How would you describe it? It's almost like people that are listening to sounds like tapping or whispering. And it's almost like a calming, it has a calming effect on the nervous system.
Yeah, it's like warm, fuzzy sounds that are really pleasant. Definitely. I think, close miking does that because when you're recording with a mic right up close to you, all these little intimate sounds, you know, in your mouth or whatever.
Right.
Come out and you're like intimately hearing. And yeah, ASMR, a lot of it is like very quiet sounds that are just really, really like
right.
you know, like ruffle.
Yeah. Or something. Exactly.
I think it's an interesting phenomenon. YouTube is an amazing resource for ASMR.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. I know some people that use that to help them fall asleep at night, but yeah, it's a very soothing to the nervous system. It's very calming, and it's not so much a tone or a note or a musical phrase. It's more of a texture.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like certain textures. Like when people spray the shaving foam, that sound.
Oh, that sound? Oh, that's a popular ASMR thing?
I think so. Nice. This could be a whole other video, by the way.
Part two, ASMR.
Right. Yeah.
Good. Yeah. Yeah. So that's one of the tracks. John also did another performance on track 19, I think. Let's see. Yeah, track 19, which maybe we should, well, should we pull, oh yeah, let me go to the Partch Ensemble performance. So last year we got commissioned, oh, well, 5 or 6 composers got commissioned to write a piece for the Partch Ensemble, and I was one of them. So I got to write, and the limitation was 5 minutes, and around 5 minutes, and just 2 or 3 instruments.
Mm.
Just a kind of a pared down version of the ensemble. And I chose an adapted guitar, the gourd tree, which you'll see these instruments in a moment, and voices and cello. And the cello plays in the tuning of the Partch, of the microtonal tuning that I chose for the piece. So we pieced together a remote recording and made a video out of it, and then premiered them virtually. So, and now it's on YouTube, so let's give it a listen. It's the very first verse of the Tao Te Ching that is perhaps the most iconic verse in the Tao. Mm-hmm. The Tao that can be, it goes, the Tao that can be told is not the eternal Tao. The name that can be named is not the eternal name. So that is maybe the most famous line in the Tao Te Ching. And it's kind of talking about how, you know, this is a whole book, but all these words can't actually describe what the Tao is. The Tao is, you know, words cannot reach this concept of the Tao, which translates to the way,
mm-hmm.
or the way of nature, the way of the universe. And so I was wanting to work with that in this piece by having an extended instrumental section where the listener could think about the concept of the Tao without words. So the beginning is the exposition of the verse. And then there's a middle section where Argenta, the vocalist, the word sings syllables, so the words are kind of melting away. And then the third section is a solo for the gourd tree, which is all instrumental. So that's the general form of the piece. And yeah, so let's give it a listen.
The Tao that can be told is not the eternal Tao. The name that can be named is not the eternal name. Heaven and earth begin in the unnamed. The named is the mother of the 10,000 things. So the unwanting soul sees what is hidden, and the ever wanting soul sees what it wants to. These two spring from the same origin, but differ in name. This appears as darkness. Darkness within darkness, the gate to all mystery. Darkness within darkness, the gate to all mystery.
Wow, that was lovely. Can we see the score to that? Yeah, I love that silence at the very end where it's just like it just fades into nothingness. I feel like that's really important to have that silence at the end, because then it's like you really take in everything that you just heard.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
That was absolutely beautiful, just like with the harmonies, and you had like elements of like where it was calming to the nervous system, and then, you know, the percussion tends to be more activating, tends to have more odd harmonic content, but like the playing with the mallets gave the attack, it made it softer, so it was just kind of more on the chime sound, it kind of mimicked more of a chime.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I just felt like everything was balanced. There wasn't, like, everything felt very cohesive. There wasn't like something that was way out in front, or, you know, it was just like everything kind of was working together, this very symbiotic kind of relationship with all the instruments and the different lines that you had.
Oh, cool.
So,
yeah,
I really enjoyed that.
Awesome. Yeah, it was really fun to write. I am excited about, hopefully one day we get to perform that live together in person.
No, that would be great to hear live.
Yeah. All right, I found the score. Let's see. Here's the score, and here's some of the intervals, just intonation intervals that are featured in the beginning, the 7-4, which is the seventh partial. The minus 31 cents that the cello is playing, that the guitar is also playing. So the cello is kind of reinforcing the guitar interval there. And yeah, notice I'm using some of that notation, which actually is in Sibelius. The arrow on the bottom, natural sign with the arrow on the bottom, kind of indicating play flatter.
Right.
So I do that. Yeah, I do that plus the ratio just to make sure that everyone knows
right
to play and sing. And yeah, this is all still the first section. These are 5-3 is like a major sixth, but, you know, significantly flatter. And then the 15-8 is a major seventh, but also flatter. And the harmonics of the cello are kind of helping reinforce that in the vocals. And so the first section, and then this is the free time section where Argenta is singing the syllables, and she's playing this 12/7, which corresponds to one of the gourd tree bowls. So she's attuning to the gourd tree there. Because she kind of does the slow glissando where she meets with the gourd tree. And then the gourd tree solo, which here it is in this section, which is the C section.
That was so beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the rest of the gourd tree. This is what they're... And I developed a special notation right here, the plus signs and the arrows for that technique where Matt was playing. He was kind of swiping the inside of the bowl with the back side of the stick. That plus sign with the arrow above is indicating that technique. Mm. Yeah.
And then what are the, you have some square notes like measure 73.
Right. So the square note is actually Parch's notation. I'm using Parch's, how Parch notated this instrument.
Mm.
He I guess he originally had 11 bells, and he added a 12th one, and he wanted it to be a square. I don't know. So I just kind of followed his notation. I know my performer was like, what, square? So I just followed his notation on that. I don't know exactly the logic behind why he didn't just renotate them, because I kind of kept along with that, which is that was in his book.
Okay.
So he has, that's, and then if you could see the square over the 5/4.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's a whole other thing, is like, how do you notate the sounds that you hear? That's a whole other podcast video that I feel like could be done.
Yeah, there's several different microtonal notation systems. Ben Johnson actually developed his own, and then Wolfgang von Schweinitz, the guy I studied with at CalArts, he developed his own as well. And of course, Partch just uses ratios, which is what I do. Yeah, any other questions about the score?
This is really cool. It's interesting how you could have written this a million different ways. I feel like there's many ways to kind of go about notating things. I feel like that would be a cool topic to kind of discuss. So I was just curious how you wrote it out, because it's very personalized. Like every score is just there's just 10 ways to do one thing, I feel like. And then you can have your own legend in the beginning of the score, where like you're using the plus signs and the dagger signs to kind of, create your own notation. I think that's what I used my own notation. I picked out symbols in Sibelius when I was writing for the danbo instrument, the Vietnamese danbo. And then I think there's a way you could draw your own symbols and stuff and then import them into Sibelius. I haven't done that yet.
Oh yeah, that's a nice feature. Yeah, I've tried that.
Yeah. Cool. Do you want to show us one more piece?
Sure. So this one is also, I'm choosing this one because it has another Partch guitar that I use. This features a technique that is really cool, where I discovered it from John Schneider, actually, where I take you play this adapted guitar with a Pyrex slide, right? If you take the slide and agitate the strings, and if the slide has to be a little rough around the edges, so the roughness kind of agitates the strings and actually creates a sustained note, almost like you're bowing. You're bowing the guitar with the slide.
Wow.
It's this kind of eerie, ghostly sound that I used for this piece. And the adapted guitar is a 10-string guitar. It's like an old Martin 12-string acoustic that got reworked to be 10 strings.
Mm-hmm.
And this also features spoken word that I use an automated computer voice. And that's another aspect of some of these DAO songs, is that I use this electronically generated voice. And I like that. There's something impersonal about it that feels, I like listening to kind of bits of wisdom in this, through this impersonal way. So that was another aspect of this piece. So here we go.
In the beginning, those who knew the Tao did not try to enlighten others, but kept them in the dark. Why is it so hard to rule? Because people are clever. Rulers who try to use cleverness cheat the country. Those who rule without cleverness are a blessing to the land. These are the two alternatives. Understanding this is primal virtue. Primal virtue is deep and far. It leads all things toward the great oneness.
Yeah, I would love to see the score to that. That it definitely had like a otherworldly, ghostly feel to that. It has a very introspective quality to it, where it almost feels like it's very not 3D world. We're very much on the other side of or in between worlds or something. But I heard that the scraping with the slide thing, and yeah, it almost felt like an Ebow or something. I know I've heard where they'll use the Ebow to kind of resonate the strings, but this felt very just human. And then with the robotic voice, just a really interesting contrast there.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I like this technique. Yeah, there's aspects of the Ebow in there, but the Ebow has, when you hear an Ebow, it's just a sustain, right?
Oh, right.
I like the kind of roughness of the, you know, rubbing sound. It's almost like this like wash of noise. It's like whoosh, 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 over the this uninterrupted sustain sound.
Mm-hmm.
It's just interesting to me that this like agitation washing of noise creates this sustain.
Do you have the score for this one?
I actually didn't. Oh. I haven't written out a score for it, just because I performed it all myself.
Wow. Do you have a video of you playing it?
No, I don't.
Okay. I wanted this to be longer. It was, I know that Tao Te Ching is, they're set, right? It's like the length of the text is set, but it was almost like my ear, I wanted to hear more. I didn't want it to be finished.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, it's kind of, you know, there's pieces that kind of feel like they overstay their welcome. I feel like this made me, it left me with like wanting to hear more. Mm. Like I wasn't ready for it to end.
Oh.
It's a good thing.
Where I extend it. Because yeah, I kind of heard that too, just listening to it right now. It's like, oh, I could hear this for longer. Yeah, it's tricky with this song cycle because it gets to be, as a whole, it's so long. It's like 2.5 hours of music.
Oh, I see. So yeah, as a collection, then it's like you want to keep each one kind of on the shorter side.
Yeah, but at the same time, I like them being modular in a way. So I don't expect people to engage with this work by listening to all 81 songs in one sitting, necessarily. Although I think that would be cool if someone wanted to do that. But I do like the idea, like when I perform these live, maybe I'll pick a subset of them, like five or six of them and then do kind of a set.
Okay.
Just a few of them. So yeah, it's kind of modular the way this song cycle works. So yeah, I could imagine this piece being longer in that context.
Yeah, I just love the ghostly quality, the introspective quality, the contrast of like instrumentation and then the voice being robotic, and then the guitar tuning doing its own thing. It's a whole other realm that I feel like a lot of composers have not explored. And I'm so happy that you're using the system. It just, your music sounds very unique and there's like nothing that, you know, sounds close to it. But yeah, thank you so much, Alex, for sharing your music and going into the tuning systems with us. And I feel like we could definitely do a part two to all this stuff, because I just really am interested in how you're kind of approaching, you know, composition and writing for, you know, these different tuning systems. So yeah, if people want to find you, where can they find you?
I have my website, alexwan.com. And so Alex is just my name, alexwan.com. And then I also have a Bandcamp. I'm releasing a new album next month.
Awesome.
So yeah, check out the Bandcamp page. But yeah, this website is a kind of hub for where I post all of my updates, and there's links to different, you know, just links to my music. So, yeah.
Very cool. Yeah, I'll post those links below this video. And yeah, thank you so much, Alex. I really enjoyed, you know, hearing you talk and having you share your music with all of us.
Thanks so much for having me, Feona. And yeah, excited to do part two. That'd be great. Thank you.